Hi, everyone. This is Waveformed, a music podcast on the Small Beans Network, where we get to know our friends better through their playlists they make. I'm Christian Ramirez, your host, and with me today is...
Katie Willert. I was trying to stifle a laugh that entire intro.
That's all right.
Oh, my God. It's Friday, guys.
Yeah, it is. It is indeed.
So how are you doing? In and out.
Oh, nice.
My mom's sitting on the couch over there, which is great. All is well.
Good.
All is well.
Good to hear.
Went on an antidepressant. My life is a lot better.
That's good.
Yes. That's about it. How are you?
I'm good.
Okay,
good. I've actually been really enjoying, because I was listening to the playlist on the way over here.
Mm-hmm.
Really enjoying
when you drove
it.
To the wrong apartment.
Yeah. I drove to Michael's old apartment,
which used to be my old apartment.
Oh,
fun fact.
Oh, well, there you go. So I guess we should probably get into the music.
Yes,
right?
Yes, yes, yes. Please.
So the first song on your playlist was Love Really Hurts Without You by Billy Ocean. Off of a 1976 album, I guess it was A and B side. This was the A side.
You did a hand motion, yeah. And I was like, I don't know what this
A
means.
B.
A and B. I understand now.
But yeah, so this one was written by Ocean under his real name, which is Leslie Charles.
Aww.
Yeah. It provided his first charting record. Provided him with his first charting record in 1976. It remains tied with the 1977 number 2 UK hit Red Light Spells Danger as Ocean's second best all-time UK charting record. And that's only second to When the Going Gets Tough, The Tough Get Going, which was number 1 for 4 weeks in the UK.
That's that background.
Yeah. Yeah, pretty much. There's a little more background. It's like kind of interesting. He considered himself the most surprised person in the world that Love Really Hurts Without You became a hit.
It's such a good
song. It is very
good.
Yeah.
The thing about Love Really Hurts Without You is okay, have you watched Sex Education on Netflix?
I haven't.
So I suggest you do because it's quite good. But mm-hmm. There's a scene. I first heard the song. My best friend played it for me after she heard it on the show. And then I watched the show. And then the moment was that much better in the show with the song. But it's such a good, bitchy boy song of like, you don't pay attention to me, but it's like with so much joy and like I just really love you and I'm sad that like you like other people.
It was funny because that's kind of an ongoing theme through your first two songs, at least this one and Upside Down, is kind of, there's definitely some common themes of like unrequited love or like liking somebody that doesn't necessarily or that isn't faithful or like
available. Sounds about right. I didn't even know that. But there's also like a BBC performance. I think it's Top of the Pops. I'm not sure, but it's on YouTube of him performing this song. He is so handsome and he's wearing a plaid jumpsuit,
mm-hmm.
like a big pointy lapel collar, mm-hmm. very like 70s.
Yeah.
And it's one of those Top of the Pops performances where it is not pre-recorded. He is singing, so it's the version vocally of that I actually like a little bit better than the album recording.
Studio version.
So I suggest everybody go find it.
No, it's really good. It resembles like the first few chords in the actual music is close to Can't Help Myself by the Four Tops.
Mm-hmm.
But I just like it's a completely different vocal and melodic thing that he does with it, and it's just really, really fun and bright, even though it's about some liking somebody that's not available.
Yeah.
It's just really, I don't know. It's the kind of thing that makes you smile.
Yeah.
When you hear it.
It's kind of like vibey to like Build Me Up Buttercup.
Yeah.
But later. I mean, like that's the thing, is it's a full on like probably 10 years after mm-hmm. that.
Yeah.
Which I think is interesting. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a throwback.
Why did it make your playlist?
Because it makes me so happy. It's one of those songs that I just feel like a lot of music I listen to makes me feel joy.
Mm-hmm.
Just like scream singing in my car, and that's one of those songs that like for sure brings me joy.
I like to picture that.
Scream singing?
Yeah. In your car to Love Really Hurts Without You.
I mean,
and I guess all of these songs.
Yeah, really, it was hard to pare it down because I listened to a lot of music.
Yeah. No, I liked it. I liked it a lot. It was apparently he'd written the original version several years earlier while he was working as a pattern cutter at a fashion house on Seville Row. And he bought a piano from his coworker for £23 just so he could start writing music.
Oh, hello, Billy Ocean.
It debuted at number 34 in the UK. He said because he was working actually at the Ford company and in a factory when it came out. He said that he was on the Ford assembly line when he heard the song on Radio Luxembourg, and it felt so good because I knew I was free to leave, so I left.
Ah, God bless. That's like the dream, isn't it? Just to be like, I'm bye. Yeah. Like, peace. I'm out. I'm going to go make music for my life now.
Yeah. It's just, I love that image. Like, that, because that's kind of something that I think a lot of people, creative people, dream of is like, especially if you have a day job.
Yeah.
It's like you just finding something out, or like you hear your song on the radio for the first time and you're just like, all right, I'm going to go be an artist full time now.
Right.
Yeah.
I have a number one hit.
Yeah.
Or exactly. A number.
It debuted at number 34. It was number two.
Yeah. I got a number two hit.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Man, it's really good. So yeah, so that's the first song. Like I said, it's just one of those things that makes you smile because it's so pretty and happy and joyous.
Even though it's about unrequited love.
Yeah. I mean, that's a lot of music though.
Yeah, that's true. There's not a lot of, I try to make a playlist of love songs where it wasn't a bad relationship.
Yeah.
Because a lot of the love songs are very like not good boundaries or anything like that. And it's very hard.
Yeah. Even with modern music stuff like Adele, or I particularly get on kicks of listening to Jimmy Eat World a lot. And that's all
Yeah. It's not, it's like some codependent, great shit or like someone's cheating or someone is. Yeah. But I think the playlist ended up having like maybe 4 or 5 songs on it. In total, that love without strings, not obligations.
And getting to that, our number two song is Upside Down by Diana Ross. I said upside down, you're turning me. You're giving love instinctively. Round and round, you're turning me. Upside down, boy, you turn me inside. It's off of her 1980 album, Diana. It was issued as a single through the Motown label in 1980 and led as the single on her 10th studio album.
And fun fact that she brought on Chic, Nile Rodgers and Chic, to produce it and help her write the like music for it. And they recorded it and brought it to Motown, and Motown was like, absolutely not. This is not Diana Ross, because it's Diana Ross.
Yeah.
Supreme's Diana Ross at that point.
Yeah.
And hadn't really done anything that was like very different auditorily, and so they wanted to put another version. And then I don't remember exactly what happened, but I have a feeling, I think it was something along the lines of like Nile Rodgers slipped the demo to like a radio station, and then they played it, and then they had to like release it with that version on it, and then it became like her big, like her biggest hit.
Yeah, I did read something like that, because I did also read, it's obvious, it's written by Bernard Edwards and Nile Rodgers of the band Chic. And in a 2011 interview, Nile Rodgers said that Diana Ross was the first big star we ever worked with, and we took it very seriously. This was the first time in her life somebody cared about who she was, what she was. Everyone previously had treated her the way that they treated Sister Sledge, just somebody to sing something. And they got her in and said, sing this. And they took a more personal approach, and that's why
they asked her, where are you at in your life?
Yeah.
They were like, how are you feeling about things? How are you? And I think she was like dating her second husband or something like that. Like the person who became her second husband. And I don't know, but she was like, I'm in like love for the first time.
And you get a number one hit out of that. It was number one on the Billboard Hot 100 chart, September 6th, 1980. It also hit number one on Billboard Disco and Soul charts. It was released full 4 weeks after the album was released, and it held down the number one spot for 4 weeks.
Yeah.
So
I also just love disco.
Yeah. I mean, and it's a giant hit. Like, yeah. I think this is one of the things, I mean, you don't think about Diana Ross like this most of the time, but it is very, I don't know, it's very disco and very, like, this is hers.
And very chic. It's, yeah. It's also very, yeah.
Yeah.
Stylistically.
Yeah, it was a huge hit internationally. Topping charts in Sweden, Italy, Norway, and Switzerland. Reached number 5 in Canada, number 2 in the UK. And it was her highest peak performance as a solo artist since I'm Still Waiting in 1971. So almost 10 years.
Damn.
And it was, yeah, her biggest song. So.
Yay.
And it's another one that, like we said, was just about somebody who's in love. And, like, they're so in love with somebody that no matter what. Like,
yeah. Yeah. Respectfully, I say to thee, I'm aware that you're cheating, but no one makes me feel like you do. Yeah. It's like, Jesus Christ, Diana. There's also on YouTube a very good live performance of this from her. She performed this song at the Forum.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so good. And then at the end, Michael Jackson comes up and, like, sings a little bit with her and dances, and it's like, it's one of those things that you're like, oh, this is just a moment.
Yeah.
Like, and it's in kind of insane.
Yeah. And longtime Small Beans listeners will know that you loved and did a performance.
I did. And spend a lot of my time being like, what the fuck, how do I reconcile this? But yeah,
I mean, but you were a kid.
I was a child.
Right.
adds so many layers. But yeah, it's, if you Google that,
yeah,
or YouTube it, it's very good. The Forum, I think it's 1983, 82. Okay.
Yeah, yeah, probably. Makes sense of the time period. And it just, why did this one make the list? Why did it make cut?
It's a groove. Like, it's a song that I will always start dancing to.
Yeah.
Also, a lot of these are, like, on my list of karaoke songs.
Nice.
But yeah, it's one of those songs that has an infectious bass line and is just a good song to just dance to.
Yeah, it's the best kind of disco. And in that, it does make you want to dance.
Yeah.
And it's also just the vocal performances. It's Diana Ross.
It's Diana Ross, and she can sing.
Yeah. This one, I will say, personally, one of my favorites that you put on the list. Number 3 is The Thrill of It All by Roxy Music. It's now or never, don't hesitate, the storm. When I call, don't spoil The Thrill of It All. Off their album Country Life in 1974.
Do you like Roxy Music? We never talked about this before, because Roxy Music is my favorite band.
I do like Roxy Music. I didn't realize how much I liked them until you gave me this playlist and I'd heard this song, and I was like, oh, these are the people that do all these other songs that I like to.
I'll send you on Spotify my Roxy Music for Beginners playlist.
Yeah. It's really good.
Enjoy it.
Yeah. I will say my little background on it. They're an English rock band that formed in 1970 by Brian Ferry, who was the band's lead vocalist, chief songwriter. Also featured,
was Brian Ferry and Brian Eno.
Yeah, Brian Eno is the other big one off of this one, out of this band. Although they took a break from group activities in 1976 and 1983, they reunited for a concert tour in 2001 and toured together intermittently between that time until their breakup in 2011.
Yeah. So, and then Brian Ferry has just been touring alone, but singing all Roxy Music songs. and we're actually going, my mom and I are going in August,
because
he's touring Avalon, which is
nice. Yeah.
Roxy Music's, like, big comeback album.
Yeah.
He's doing the entirety of the album.
Yeah, Avalon's one of those singles that's one of the ones that I remembered. Once I saw the title of it, I was like, oh, that's who this is.
Might I suggest listening to Flesh and Blood, which is their 1981 or 82 album that is all synthy and beautiful and great.
Oh,
and there's
nice.
Some weird covers on it.
Yeah, I will
like
listen
Midnight
to that.
Hour and 8 Miles High.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, and like I said, this was probably maybe my favorite one off of this list, just because this is very in my wheelhouse of stuff that I like. Other songs, other singles that they've done include Virginia Plain, Street Life, Love is the Drug, Dance Away, Angel Eyes, Over You, Oh Yeah, Jealous Guy, Avalon, of course, and More Than This. And of course, Brian Eno collaborated with David Bowie on his Berlin trilogy, which includes Low, Heroes, and Lodger. And then from 1978 to 1980, he collaborated with Talking Heads. Yep. So Brian Eno has a very big influence on that era of music.
Yeah, it's funny. I was listening to, there's a song of Brian Eno's called I'll Come Running. And it is very, like, you listen to that song and you go, ah, I understand where the music, like, I understand what part of Roxy Music mm-hmm. is his sound.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Brian Ferry's like the bravado front man mm-hmm. who wears a fucking eye patch. And, and, you know, it's very funny, too, because he's like the son of a coal miner. But his whole vibe is like aristocrat.
Yeah, glam rocky. Yeah.
And it's a very weird. I'm like, oh, it's such a put on. Like, you were like a country bumpkin and you started wearing nice suits and dating Jerry Hall. And
yeah. And it's like the vocal style is very similar to Bowie, too. Mm-hmm. Like, you can hear the
similarity.
Yeah, he's a warbly.
He's a wailer. Yeah. He's not a particular, like, technically a very good singer.
Right.
And that's actually a thing I really enjoy is mm-hmm. male vocalists who are not technically the best singers, but have a lot of like weird emotion in their voice.
Oh, okay.
And that's why I like Brian Ferry.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
That makes sense why you like new wave music too then.
Yeah. Is I'm very predictable.
That's just something that we've talked about before.
Yes,
yeah.
I do enjoy new wave music. Mm.
They were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 2019. Mm. They had 3 number one albums, so I mean, and if you do listen to Roxy Music, you can, and then listen to stuff that came out in the 80s and 90s, you can hear their influence.
I love, so the thrill of it all is a song that is perfect as far as I'm concerned. Mm-hmm. Like, the build, the orchestration in it, mm-hmm. And his voice, and it just builds so nicely.
And I love the energy of the whole thing.
It gets me really pumped up. Yeah. Like, I was living on a friend's couch and I had no job and I was like really stressed out. I would take a walk every morning and I would just listen to that song on repeat and just be like, just walking with a purpose. Like, let's move through something.
I can see that.
Just keep this happening. Like, keep going, Katie.
Yeah,
just
it
keep
is.
Keep going.
It's, again, it is a song that makes you like that. Pumps you up and makes you want to move, I guess.
Yeah, it's now or never. Don't hesitate or stall when I call. It's a good lyric.
Yeah. And so is that why this one made the list? It's got a very,
It's like,
it's
and
very
it is
tied to that time
that
period.
Moment. Yeah. And it was like right as everything was kind of changing in a good way.
Yeah. It's like Salisbury Hill for you.
Oh, I like Salisbury Hill.
I do like that one too. I like Peter Gabriel as well.
Me too. Sledgehammer. Another
of course.
Karaoke song. Did I put that on my list?
You did not.
No, it almost made it.
Yeah.
Almost.
I like that whole album, though. Okay.
So.
Yeah. We don't even talk about Peter Gabriel right now, because that's not on the list. But our next song, number 4, is going to be Honky Cat by Elton John off of Honky Chateau in 1972. Another one that's a really fun song. It's reached number 31 in the UK, and it's the song fared better in the US, hitting number 8. It was on the same album as Rocket Man.
It's very funny, when I was like 7 or 8, I found the Elton John Greatest Hits like CD. It was my mom's, and I would listen to it a lot. And I remember, like, I had to do this huge research project in like the 3rd or 4th grade. It was like, it was a very intense project for the 3rd or 4th grade. And I remember like assembling like pieces of it on the dining room table while listening to, and I specifically remember listening to Honky Cat and always liking it because I really love like rock honky tonky piano in songs. It's one of my favorite things. Like, there's a song by NRBQ called Magnet that has like some really bitchin', you know, rock piano in it. But so I knew, like, I knew all the like pretty famous Elton John songs by the time I was like 9.
The greatest hits ones.
And then when I was in my teen years, my dad had a greatest hits Elton John CD that was spanned more time.
Oh.
So that had stuff that was like Island Girl and Philadelphia Freedom and Bitches Back and Don't Go Breaking My Heart. Mm. And then I like had a renaissance of love for Elton John in my teen years.
Yeah.
And then I was so happy in Rocket Man when what happened during Honky Cat, like how they used it in the movie.
Okay.
It's like him and John Reed like buying all of the expensive things, and like they're like walking through stores, and there's all this like clothing and this like nice car, and it's it's great. It made me really happy.
Yeah, I went. It was similar that I was exposed. I was only exposed to Elton John that I can remember when I was in my teens already, and they did have like it was the 2-disc greatest hits, so it wasn't.
It's the white one with his the yellow and the yellow glasses. That was the one that my dad had.
Yeah,
yeah,
and so that one, yeah. I mean, of course. At the time, I think I attached more to the songs that were more popular, and I'm kind of a sap when it comes to some stuff, a sappy romantic, and specifically your song is one that I would listen to over and over because I was also an emo kid, so I was like, oh, this fits with my personality at the time, so yeah, and yeah, I don't know, if you haven't heard the song, and listen to more Elton John.
Honky Cat's great.
Yeah.
So good.
And of course, it's came from the partnership between him and Bernie Taupin.
Who, as I learned from Rocket Man, Bernie Taupin fucked. Like, literally, that's like every time they're anywhere together, Bernie Taupin has like two women on his arms and is like going somewhere else.
Yeah.
I think Bernie Taupin was like, it's okay if you just, you can say anything about me in this movie, but just make sure people know that I fuck. Like,
and for other people who don't know who Bernie Taupin is, it's Elton John's songwriting partner.
Mm-hmm.
For, I mean, for years and years, decades, they wrote songs together. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
His biffle.
Mm-hmm. And so why did this one make the cut? Was it because like it's attached to...
It's been my favorite Elton John song since I was 9.
Well,
so that's like, okay.
That
deserves a spot.
Definitely has seniority.
21 years of loving Honky Cat.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
The next one, number 5, is The Beast by Johanna Samuels, or Johanna. I don't know how to pronounce her.
Johanna.
Yeah, Johanna Samuels. From the album Home and Dry, Told a Lie in 2016.
Said he'd never thought he'd see me going, but then again he must have had a way of knowing that one more winter would turn into the next.
Yes. So
this one was, I couldn't like find a lot of information on this one, but why is it on the list?
Johanna Samuels is my best friend from childhood.
Really?
Yes. And we used to make movies together with her, the camcorder and her like big like Mac, like orange Mac.
Yeah.
Like she had the very original editing software, and we would make movies. And she started playing music when we were like playing the guitar when we were like 9.
Oh, wow.
And she tried to teach me how to play the piano when we were kids, and I did not care for it. But she's been a musician ever since, and she is so supremely talented, and she's such a beautiful songwriter. Like,
yeah.
I try and tell her as often as I possibly can, like, you were put on this earth to write songs. Mm. Like, you lyrically are gifted.
Yeah.
But this song particularly is just such a beautiful like example of that push and pull between doing things the way they've always been done and trying something new.
Yeah.
But I think it was like, if I remember correctly, I think it was about her like moving from New York to LA and like,
that makes sense.
One more winter would turn to the next. So it's like that, if we're never going to leave, if we don't leave, we're never going to leave.
Right.
And I just love, there's a lyric in it that always gets me. It would be such a disservice to myself to stay because I don't want to change, so I push you away.
Mm-hmm.
And that thing of like me staying the same is not doing anybody any good.
Like, yeah.
I need to change and I need to grow. And so I just like, I love her so much and I want her to make music forever.
Yeah.
And that song in particular on YouTube, there is a, she did a Tiny Desk like submission video.
Yeah.
That's her live at a piano singing this song. And, it's so good. It's so good. I'm sorry. I just love her so much. And
it is a very pretty song.
I'm like, hey, let's everybody listen to Johanna Samuels, please.
I don't think that you're exaggerating how good the song is, because it's very touching to me, too. And I don't have any personal connection to it. It's just listening to it lyrically and melodically. It's sad and very pretty. And just it is one of the ones that I listened to multiple times afterwards, because it's like, oh, I want to dig into this song. I want to understand what's going on in here better.
Yeah. It's one of those ones that I cry when I listen to it.
Yeah.
I love that. I met the people who comprise my heart. That lyric is another one that really, as like finding those people who are the ones who are your community and yeah. support you. That's like,
you got to find your tribe.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He's very good.
Yeah, it's very good.
And I love her a lot.
So it's pretty clear why this one made the cut.
My sweet Bojan. Yeah. That was her nickname. Well, we used to call her JoJo, which I still do, but Bojan was her nickname. Oh. Her AIM handle was Bojan.
Don't need to get into AIM handles.
She was Bojan and I was Spoger, and it was great.
Oh,
and
cute.
Things were simpler then.
Very sweet.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to go on to number 6, which is Wichita Lineman by Glenn Campbell.
I am a lineman for the county, and I drive the main road, searching in the sun for another overload.
Off of the album Wichita Lineman in 1968. I like this one a lot too.
Yay!
This is another like classical country song that is obviously very different than modern country.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also like, to me, it's a perfect fusion of pop and country sound.
Yeah, it's a very late 60s song. Like the orchestration, even though it has a more of a country bent, is still very like orchestral.
Yeah. Just little facts on this one. It was written by American songwriter Jimmy Webb in 1968. He was inducted into the Songwriters Hall of Fame in 1986 and the Nashville Songwriters Hall of Fame in 1990. And he received the National Academy of Songwriters Lifetime Achievement Award in 1993. His song, By the Time I Get to Phoenix, was the third most performed song in the 50 years between 1940 and 1990.
Mm.
So, obviously this is a songwriter who was...
prolific?
Like, yeah, prolific and...
Question
like,
mark?
This song was written when he was like at his peak, too. Mm-hmm. So it's because right in the middle of that time period. This song in particular really reached number 3 on the U.S. pop chart, remaining in the top 100 for 15 weeks. It's a very good song, and I understand why it had staying power, too, because it's definitely one that I could see myself just listening to. It would come on. It's one of those ones that I wouldn't skip when it comes on a playlist.
Yeah.
When I just have my iPod on shuffle kind of a thing. And that I would probably listen to most of the time.
Yeah. I've entered into my Glenn Campbell phase of my music listening. His voice is just so technically good. Like listening to him hit all the notes with such power. But the song is just... I don't know. It's about like a trucker.
Yeah.
Is he a trucker? I don't exactly know.
I'm pretty
know.
Sure he is a trucker.
But yeah, it's just one of those wistful, like lilting orchestral songs, and lyrically, that you know, and I need you more than want you, and I want you for all time.
It's
God
another
damn.
One. Yeah. That's you know, another
like,
one that's,
yeah, it's Jesus.
That's like sad and slow, but also very beautiful in the way that it's composed.
Yeah.
It's
I also just like the lyric, and I need a small vacation. A small vacation. And I need a small vacation. Just like, okay. Not a regular sized vacation,
no,
just like a long weekend.
Just a little one. Like a staycation maybe.
Yeah. But he's a trucker.
Just a few days
so
off.
Yeah, just head to a motel in Arizona, I'm guessing. Stop doing amphetamines for a hot second. Take some time off.
That would probably help.
Yeah. White crosses are what they called the speed that truckers would take.
That makes sense.
Little white pills with a
cross
on
them. Yeah.
Yeah. Fun fact.
So why did this one make the list?
Because it is just one of those sweeping songs. And I also like, it's each of the songs that's on this playlist is like a subsection of my musical, and the type of music that I enjoy. And so I do really like country, like not country music per se, but I love the country sound.
Yeah.
And I like a lot of like late 60s, early 70s kind of country.
Yeah.
And then I like kind of rockabilly-y. Like, oh, that makes sense. I've been listening to a lot more Chris Isaak lately, which is always great. Forever Blue is a very good album.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I just... It's just wistful and sad, and his yeah. voice is so beautiful, and the strings on this song are really gorgeous yeah. as well. So
yeah, I recently like Wicked Game made it back into
yeah.
my like rotation recently for whatever yeah. reason.
I Believe is very good.
Yeah,
yeah. yeah.
Chris Isaac's good too.
Yeah. yeah,
but this is about Glenn Campbell.
Yeah, so. Sorry, but yeah, Glenn Campbell also great.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, Southern Nights that's... also good. I've been listening to that song a lot. As
okay.
well.
Yeah, there's a British music journalist, Stuart McConey, and he called it the greatest pop song ever composed, which
really?
Is quite a claim.
That's a lot. That's a big old statement.
And like, I can see why he would think that.
Yeah.
It's very pretty. Okay, and that brings us to number 7, which is Working On It by J Dilla off the album Donuts, 2006.
I think everybody should listen to more J Dilla. This song is very interesting because it is entirely the beat, the whole beat of it is samples a song by 10cc called Worst Band in the World, which I only know of 10cc because of Michael Swaim. But I actually started listening to J Dilla before I knew, like, listened to any 10cc.
Okay.
And the whole album, Donuts, is quite good, and it's kind of a... It's so upsetting that J Dilla is dead
yeah.
And that we don't get to hear what he would do with everything, like including hip hop today. Like if yeah. he were still alive, who would he work with and what would he make? Because he was so creative, and the sample, it's really like all parts of the Buffalo, like every
yeah.
part of Worst Band in the World is in there and makes a totally different song.
Mm-hmm.
That is so great. Yeah. I don't have much more to say about J Dilla except that he's amazing and everyone
yeah.
should listen to. The Shining is also another good album that is... He has one that's entirely instrumental and one that is not... That is all the... has everybody doing their verses on it.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a song, Geek Down, I think is what it's called. It's him and Busta Rhymes.
Okay.
And it is... excellent because they use a kazoo orchestra playing Flight of the Bumblebee that he samples, and it's really great.
That sounds great.
But yeah, I think like Working On It is the perfect example of what a genius he was in terms
yeah.
of like sampling things.
Yeah. Yeah. Donuts was the second studio album, and it was actually released on the day of his 32nd birthday, which was 3 days before he died.
Yep.
And it was the final album released during his lifetime. In 2002, he'd been diagnosed with thrombocytopenic purpura. It's an incurable disease of the blood.
Yeah, and he had lupus as well.
And he also
right?
had lupus.
Yeah.
Which had been diagnosed a year previously. But that didn't stop him from working on these albums, actually, while he was in the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
In an interview with The Fader, his mother, Maureen Yancey, who was apparently a former opera singer.
I did not know that.
Said of the album, I got a glimpse of the music during one of the hospital days around his 31st birthday when a friend and producer House Shoes came out from Detroit to visit him. I would sneak in and listen to the work in progress while he was in dialysis. He got furious when he found out I was listening to his music.
Huh.
He didn't want me listening to anything that was until it was a finished product. Yeah, he was working in the hospital. He tried to go over each beat and make sure that it was something different and make sure that there was nothing that he wanted to change.
I think his mother donated his Moog, like, synth.
Yeah.
Or his sampling machine or something like that to the National Museum of African American History
oh, wow.
in D.C. So it's there, like, in yeah. a, in a plastic like display box, which I think is rad.
That is rad. Yeah. So this one, why this one made the list, just because it's representative of that, like that type of music.
Yes, but also just because it is, I think, just such a creative sample way of sampling, and it combines 10cc and hip hop, which is like great as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, it's very good. Everybody should listen to it. Everybody should have already
listened to all of these songs
before you listen to the podcast.
Oh, is that the rule? Then
I think that should be the rule.
Okay.
I'm not making a rule that you have to, but you should.
I think that's interesting. It
gives you context for what you're going to hear us talk about.
Right.
And number 8 song is Janitor by Suburban Lawns. Of their album Suburban Lawns in 1981. Yeah. this one's very post-punk, like
there's synth. It's new wavy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a very interesting combination of all those things.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, but because you can definitely hear all the punkiness to it, and you can hear the beginning of the 80s bleeding into it with the synths too. So
yeah. It's Suburban Lawns. My friend Paul showed me a performance of this particular song on a like public access music show in LA. And apparently they had just performed on SNL, but it was like in the lost years. It was 80 to 85 that no one really remembers or thinks about. And the song was written because Sue Tissue, spelled S-U is the first name in Tissue. She was a janitor. That was like her day job. Mm-hmm. And when someone asked her, like, what do you do? She said, I'm a janitor. And the person was like, what? And she goes, I'm a janitor. And then she goes, oh, I thought you said, oh, my genitals. Mm-hmm. So the chorus of this song is, I'm a janitor. Oh, my genitals. I'm a janitor. Oh, my genitals. Which I think is hilarious. Because Suzy Shue is this tiny, like, very unassuming woman. And... like she looks like she should be like a cashier at a fucking drugstore. Yeah. And she is so weird in this song. She does a weird thing with her voice. But I'm a huge fan of like female-led, like post-punk bands. And this song in particular, every song that they have is also like under 2 minutes, which is like really fun.
Yeah.
But all of that album, Suburban Lawns, it's on Spotify, but all of that album is fantastic.
Yeah, yeah. My biggest note about it was that it was bright, weird, and playful.
Yeah.
It's very...
At one point she goes, who's your mother? Who's your father? I just like when people do weird shit with their voices and they're like, I don't care. Yeah, it's great. And it's that thing where lyrics don't quite make sense.
No, yeah.
And another fun thing is Sue Tissue, they can't find her. Like, she literally disappeared. The band broke up right after they released this album. And they kind of lost track of each other. And a bunch of people were wondering, like, where is Sue Tissue? Like, what is she doing? Mm-hmm. And so a Facebook group was created. And the guy who started it, everybody was like, oh, I think she might be here. I think she might be there, whatever. The guy who started the Facebook group actually found her.
Mm-hmm.
And he reached out to her prior to telling everybody else, like, hi, I'm a huge fan of yours. Like, how are you? And he goes, I would love to like talk or whatever. And she was just like, I don't really want to be like found.
Okay.
Like she was fine, but she was just like, that was a part of my life that I don't associate with.
It was on purpose
anymore.
That I.
Mm-hmm. And so he told everybody in the group like, hey, I found her. She's fine. She doesn't want to be talked to. And everybody was like, okay. And then that was the end of it.
That's good.
Which I was like, oh, good job respecting people's wishes.
That's good.
Yeah.
I just wanted to read off some of these people, the members of the band's aliases, not their actual names, because they're very funny. Vex Billingsgate, Sue Tissue, obviously. Frank Ennui, Chuck Roast, and John Gluer.
Also, if you watch that it's on YouTube, the performance on that cable access, like nobody in the band looks like they should be in the band, like together. The drummer's like in like gym clothes, and then like one of the guys just looks like preppy 80s guy. Yeah. And then like, and then she, there's her and she's in like one of those Victorian blouses with like a cameo at the neck and like, just like not bad posture. Like yeah. none of them look, it's like the Breakfast Club. Like none yeah. of them look like they should be in a band.
Yeah.
Which is, I think, also why I like it.
Yeah. And I'm guessing this one made the list because that this is pretty much the only like punk song on the list.
Yeah. I just like it so much. It's been a new, it's been a fairly new yeah. like addition to my musical lexicon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so it brings us to number 9, which is She Bad by Cardi B, off of Invasion of Privacy, which is 2018.
Mama needs some meal money, Prada bag and heel money. See my ex, he still love me. You a nigga gon' kill for me. All my chains got diamonds in it. My account got commas in it. Damn daddy, you fine as hell. I hope your wallet got commas in it.
I love Cardi B. I also really like modern rap, and so this is kind of like that. Part of my musical interests, but particularly this song, I just like it because it's literally her talking about how amazing she is. Mm-hmm. And then YG's verse on it is also great because it's, I actually find it weirdly romantic because he's just talking about like, oh my God, you're amazing. You figured it out.
Yeah.
Like you're from the trap. You look insanely good. And like, you got these bitches beat, they run in laps. Mm-hmm. It's just like, it's a weirdly like respectfully in awe verse,
yeah.
Which is great. Also, it's just, I like songs where they repeat things over and over again. And the chorus is just, she bad, she bad, she mm-hmm. bad, she bad, she bad, she drip, she swag. And then at one point he's just like, Gucci bag, Fendi bag, Prada bag, Louis bag, Gucci bag, Birkin bag, Uchi bad, Uchi. Also, this, the other reason why I love this song so much is when she performed at, Cardi B performed at Coachella when she was like 8 months pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
She, this is the song where he was just like, she bad. And she just like bends over and is just twerking. She's like fucking pregnant and she's twerking. And it's so amazing. Like, yeah. I'm just like, you are powerful. For me, seeing someone like Cardi,
yeah.
the thing about her whole Coachella performance is it opened up with this like slideshow video of all of her social media posts and things like where yeah. she came from.
Yeah.
And it was just like, she's wanted to do this for forever. Mm-hmm. Like even when she was stripping, she was like, this is, I've always wanted to do this. And yeah. like watching her trajectory, I'm watching someone who isn't being entirely authentic as mm-hmm. themselves and resonate with so many people. I really like her and I, you know,
yeah,
I don't know. I also just love when she's like a huge history buff and she knows more about the presidents than most people. yes. And
her political rants are very funny and astute.
But that's the thing is it's like, I think that point of view is important and I yeah. think her voice is important and I think that she has an audience that she is reaching.
Yeah.
I don't know. I like appreciate her
yeah.
a whole hell of a lot and yeah. it's just such a good, she's just great.
Yeah. And just the fact that she's an artist, a female artist in hip hop who is completely confident and completely owns who she is and everything that she does. And like, she's really good.
Mm-hmm.
The world conspires against people like that. And yep. she just overcomes all of it. And it's yeah. great.
And also that video of her from that Love and Hip Hop reunion where she's calling out this guy who's such a piece of shit and he's calling her a whore and he's calling her all this because she was, you know, a stripper and,
yeah.
and all this shit. And she just was like, no, 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 you don't get to do that. Like, I know they can't say anything because his two ex-wives or his ex-girlfriend and ex-wife were like sitting next to him.
Mm-hmm.
She was like, I know they can't say anything, but I'm going to say exactly what your problem is. And he just like keeps being like, you're just a slut, you're just a slut. Like, just essentially just trying throwing all of these things at her yeah. to see what would stick, and nothing stuck. And she was like, you're a fucking asshole and here's why, and you're embarrassing these mm-hmm. women. And it was just, it's, I just really enjoy her
yeah
a lot.
And this one particular, this song entered at number 57 on the Billboard Hot 100 the week following the album's release. Variety's Jim Aswad said, it's almost a given that the lyrics are whip smart and hilarious. And Rolling Stone's Rob Sheffield said, her raw humor might tempt people to sleep on her deeply schooled sensibility, but something that always sets Cardi apart is her eccentric sense of hip hop history.
Yep.
Yeah. And why did this one just, you love this one?
Yeah. I mean, that it's that thing of lyrically, I think it's pretty great.
Mm-hmm.
And YG's verse on it is really good too. And I'm sad because I feel like it kind of got buried in that album. Like, I mean, they're obviously not all going to be singles, but I think I was just like, fuck, this is such a banger. And like, I don't think it's ever going to, I think it's, you know, obviously the album has been out and it will be out and she's moving on. But
yeah
that music video for Press, I don't know how I feel about it, but that's different. It's a conversation for a different.
So, yeah.
She ends up like murking a lot of people.
Oh, okay.
But it's a thing where it's like, I get what the thought of it was, but the visual is very upsetting because it's a lot of people who are shot lot of blood and it's a lot of dead bodies. And I'm just like, I don't know if this visual was the right.
Yeah.
I know the idea, but I don't know if the visual was the right way to go. But we're all human.
Yeah, exactly.
We're all trying our best, guys.
That's all we can do is try our best.
Yeah.
All right. And finally, number 10 is going to be Staying Power by Queen. Which came out on Hot Space in 1982. This particular version was live at Milton Keynes Bowl, which was in June 1982. And there is a big difference between the live version and the studio version.
Yes.
Yeah.
So Hot Space is the album that Queen fans hate. And it's unfortunate because I think it's very good. This is problematic now, but it is one of the... auditorily is one of the biggest inspirations for the album Thriller.
Yeah.
That
makes sense.
A lot of the horns and things like that. So I like the album version too. It's like very synthy and very like
more disco-y.
Disco funk type. But the version of this one is live and it is funk at the speed of punk, I guess is like the right way to put it.
That's
where
very good. Yeah.
It's like double speed and delightful.
Yeah. That was one of my notes because I listened to the studio version too, is that the studio version is slower, features a lot more electronic elements.
Yeah,
the horns are more prominent.
And no drum.
Yeah.
Like it's a drum machine as opposed to Roger Taylor.
Yeah, and the live version is just a very driving, like you said, it's funk at the speed of punk. Yeah. It's very good. It's really fun. Like John Deacon, who's usually the bassist, actually played rhythm guitar instead of bass on the live version.
It's very interesting too when you listen to it how fast he's going.
Mm-hmm.
It is one of those things where it's an entirely different song.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of people in the if you go to the YouTube link of it, a lot of people are like, I wish it would have been this on the album. I wish it would have been this on the album. And I was like, the album version is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if people just holistically listen to Hot Space has Under Pressure on it, which.
Yeah.
Hot, like that song was just kind of tacked onto the album. It wasn't
written
for the album. But Hot Space is the album that has the body language on it. Staying Power, Action This Day, Calling All Girls, Palabras de Amor, which is the sappiest fucking song, but I love it so much. It's a synthy, funky, disco Queen album, and I actually really enjoy it. Cool Cat is also on it, and Back Chat, which are two very, very good songs. Cool Cat is the funkiest fucking song. I feel like if people just listen to the album, I think they'd find at least one song that isn't Under Pressure on it that they would enjoy.
Yeah, I mean, and it's Queen, so obviously, I think it's just like the expectations were different than what they delivered with the album.
Yes.
And so that's why people like, because it is very different.
Yeah, it's not about like aristocratic ladies and prostitutes and we're at the opera and all, you know.
Mm-hmm. But it's really good. I like the version that you picked better.
Which is a bonus track on the deluxe version of Hot Space.
Yeah. And I mean, but I'm a more... for somebody who's more into rock and stuff like that, then I appreciate disco, and especially stuff like Queen, which is rock/disco in that particular song especially. But I do, I mean, and Freddie Mercury is always amazing. The music's always going to be good. Mm-hmm. Like it's always going to be very technically proficient no matter what the song is by Queen. So I don't know. If you give it a chance, if you like Queen at all.
Yeah. I think just open mind. Open mind, guys. Have an open mind.
And I think that's kind of important with this particular like kind of thing. When we're talking about music at all, you kind of have to have an open mind because everybody has different tastes. And so it's not really, there isn't a way to say my taste is better than yours. Mm-hmm. And I think that's something that, I mean, I definitely went through when I was a teenager, like thinking that I had superior musical taste just because I listened to stuff that was from the 70s. And like, oh, I listened to Led Zeppelin. So
I was just about to say, I was like, I'm 12 and I listen to Led Zeppelin and I am cooler than all of you.
So I'm cooler. Yeah, exactly. But I think, and that's kind of why I wanted to do this podcast, is just because I like to listen to, I like to hear other people's, like the stuff that they love, because I think it's, it definitely is a good way to get to know people. It's like, if you want to know somebody better, you can watch their favorite movie. And this is just the musical version of that.
Yeah, I feel like for me, and I'm incredibly grateful that I do genuinely like pretty much every genre of music. Yeah. Like I can find stuff that I like there in it. And it is fun, like talking to people, like going down the rabbit hole of like, oh my God, if you like this, you might also like this, and all, you know, and being like, oh, this is definitely a mashup of these two things or whatever. Like I feel like you get to know somebody so much better when you get to talk about the music you love.
Yeah. And it's really good. I really enjoyed this playlist. There are definitely songs on it. Like I said, Roxy Music is going to be one that I'm going to
send you that link of that beginner playlist.
I'm going to fall into a deep Spotify hole because now I got the premium for so I could do this.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, well, I guess
now
I'm going to be listening
to
that
all
now.
The time. Yay. No ads.
Yeah, exactly. And yeah, thank you for coming on and being the first guest.
Thank you for having me. I'm so excited.
Yeah, I'm really glad that I got to talk about music with you.
Same.
Is there anything else? Any bonus tracks that you think that you'd recommend if people like this playlist?
Oh, damn.
What other songs are very Katie Willert?
Oh, hold on. Let me open up my Spotify and see what I've been listening to recently. Let's see. I have a series of playlists. It's one started as a smattering, which is just like a mix of a bunch of songs. And then once it got too long, I started smattering two. And now I'm on smattering three.
The smattering three.
Okay, let's see. I really love... Oh, I've gotten into Sparks recently, which is new. So... Mm-hmm. Songs like Amateur Hour, Here in Heaven, When I'm With You. When I'm With You is very good. It's a really sweet, corny love song. I'm also started getting into Nick Lowe. Specifically the song All Men Are Liars. It is a delightful. Mm-hmm.
I know one that we talked about before. We had talked about Tears for Fears before.
Yes.
Yeah. And I do too.
How about this? Lucky Number by Lean Lovitch is also quite good.
Nice.
And Strut by Sheena Easton. Yeah. I'm all over the place, guys. Sorry.
No, that's good. I think all over the place is the kind of stuff that people are going to like if they want to listen to this podcast. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yay.
Well, yeah. Thank you.
Thanks for having me.
And I don't really know how to close the show.
This has been a Small Beans Endeavor. We're a bunch of pals who make podcasts, sketches, music, web series, and movies. The beans always have new ideas percolating, so make sure to check us out at patreon.com/smallbeans. That's patreon.com/smallbeans, where you can browse all of our current and past content, see what we've got planned in the future, and learn how your support can help the small beans grow into huge, giant monster beans. If you enjoyed this content module, please like, rate, subscribe, or tell a friend about us. We love you!